Thank you, Martin. As Martin said, I'm a panorama photographer, in a way that makes me the odd one out in this conference. Fortunately, I've been finding out that many of the people here are also the odd one out. Even so, the last time I touched that paintbrush is a very long time ago, that I make a lot of panoramas. This, by the way, which I've cleverly set up to show while you're entering, is a screensaver that uses panoramic image in the background. This is the type of panoramic images I take when I do my panoramic work. This is at the June of the Panorama Mesa at last year's IPC conference. Like the painted panorama images that you're used to looking at from the center, this panorama exhibits some interesting curves. Of course, if you would look at the panorama from the center, those curves wouldn't necessarily be there. This is the same image, only it gets corrected perspectively, so you can have a look around, see some familiar faces, and see the panorama mist up. I'm Marenke. Even see the ceiling and see the dune itself. This is not what this presentation will be about. If you want to know more about this type of panoramic photography, Ian Wood and myself will be doing one of the workshops this afternoon. And unfortunately, there's been a slight mix-up in the program with the description of our workshop. It will really focus on panoramic photography, how to do it yourself, and we'll be walking through the whole process, making panoramic images, making them interactive. Some of the things I, of course, this is my daily work, making them interactive. So I want to show some exciting things that have been under development lately. We've been seeing lots of moving panoramas during the conference so far. And this is my latest moving panorama, taken at a waterfall in San Francisco, at a conference actually of panoramic photographers. So we have our own conferences. Haven't had as many as the IPC yet, but we're working on that. So, but apart from looking at panoramas interactively, this is, by the way, an image I took yesterday on the boat. It's not my best panorama ever, but I wanted to take something anyway, even though it rained. At this time it was quite dark, so this is an 8-second exposure, which explains why the people over here are rather blurred and why the water looks very flat. But the boat is nice and the boat itself is nice and sharp because it's the boat was stationary. It was just moving along on the water. So you can look at the panoramas interactively, but you can also go and look for interesting perspectives in the image. Here we see a somewhat peculiar yet very familiar perspective where the horizon has become a circle. This is something that among panorama photographers became very popular in a very very short time span because of some software that became available and some tips and tricks to do this kind of stuff. And the interesting thing is that many of these panorama photographers don't realize how basically old this kind of projection is, because we've seen quite a lot of painted panorama floor plans that are basically the same perspective with a round horizon and basically the scene sticking out from that. Like I said, this is my work. These interactive panoramas are used on the internet a lot, and when they're used on the internet, they reach a huge audience. I think, especially outside this room, we can safely say that there are probably, if you say the word panorama to someone, probably there are more people that have seen an interactive panorama like I showed it than people that have actually been to a painted panorama. Now that's, let me be clear about that, not something about the value or the quality of both. Because I think the people who actually remember visiting a painted panorama and the people who actually remember seeing an interactive panorama, like I showed, that's a totally different number. But interactive panoramas on the web reach an enormous amount of people. Then again, it's always a single person sitting behind a computer looking at a screen with a mouse clicking and dragging to have a look around. It's always a very egocentric experience, only one person at a time. Of course, many persons can watch in their own time all over the world. They don't have to come somewhere to experience it. But it's always about one person. In this presentation, I will show a couple of installations that I've worked on, where I've tried to do something with my type of panoramic photography that is less about the one person egocentric experience. And less about computers, basically. I think one of the reasons the interactive panoramas, so on-screen panoramas, like I just showed them, why they're maybe not really impressive, is that they are bound to a computer. They are bound to the mouse that people also use in their daily work. Whereas a painted panorama was really something very special. So what I've basically been trying to do is make my panoramic photography special again. One of the main reasons I started trying to make my panoramic photography special again is that I was asked at a number of different occasions to make an installation at a art festival, for example, or at the Panorama Mesa, where people just wouldn't be captivated by a computer screen and a mouse. So that just wouldn't be interesting enough. So I needed to come up with something else. And I decided to borrow some more tricks. So the panorama is, of course, an old trick. I decided to go back even further into the Renaissance and use my panoramic imaging and some more tricks. this in this installation was designed for an open air art festival, a very small art festival, but an art festival nevertheless, celebrating the light. And it would basically be a lot of people walking around in a park in total darkness with light-related art installations. One of the art installations I did there was this type of basically a pub table, because there would be drinks at this festival. So I wanted to get people to, well, basically come to my installation without them actually noticing that they were stepping towards their art installation. So a pub table, and I would put a print like the one here, which is again the very familiar round horizon perspective. This, by the way, is a panorama of the fireworks festival in Scheveningen, and Mesdag would have stood all the way over here on the horizon. So it's not all that far from Mesdagduin, Sijnpolsduin. But of course, Sijnpolsduin has long since been excavated. So this type of image placed on a table with, in the center of the table, a somewhat larger than this, but a cylindrical mirror. And people would get around there, put their drinks on the table, and they'd see this mirror. And like a magic mirror, people would go, "Ooh, I'm reflected in this, ooh, I'm distorted." But they would also see a reflection of the print that was on the surface of the table. There was a light below the print, so the print emitted some light, making the tables even more attractive to gather around. Now, something I forgot to mention at the beginning of this talk is that I'm doing a lot of live demos, and live demos can go wrong, so it's a bit of a risk, but this is promising. I couldn't bring a whole bar table, so instead I took a part of a print of the image that was just on the view, or on the slide. I took a smaller cylindrical mirror, and hopefully, when focusing properly, I may have to use my tripod to less. Okay, so this is the image as it would be on the table, placing the mirror on there, you get a very tiny yet cute depiction. Oh. Depiction of the scene, and I have to light it, otherwise the video quality would suffer even more, but that also means we get some more reflection than we should get. But in looking into the mirror, you see the panorama straightened out again. And the fun thing is, if you move the camera, or in this case, Ian was friendly enough to move the scene, but if you move your head around the mirror, the angle at which you see the scene changes, sorry, the angle at which you look into the mirror changes, which changes the reflection because of the cylindrical nature of the reflection. That does some strange things with your perception. It makes it a lot more spatial than it actually is. It's a flat image, but because the reflection moves when you move your head, your perceptive system gets, well, sort of fooled, and things, it's more spatial. At the same time, I was experimenting with panoramic video. This parabolic mirror will be explained in a bit more detail at this afternoon's workshop. It's used to make panoramas in just one go. No, it's here. Now, this is the same camera I just used. It's now shooting a video upwards onto the mirror, and because the mirror has this curve, it then basically sees all around. So I can go all around, and you see me doing a complete circle there. Interestingly, if this were outside, you'd see a circular horizon. So the image you get out of this is very similar to the type of image I've been using with my cylindrical mirror. Of course, there's a big difference. Namely, there's a stem in the center that's... Go ahead, you'll see yourself. And there's a stem in the center that's holding up the parabolic mirror part. So there's a black hole, but basically when you take the round horizon image and put a mirror in the center, you're losing a bit anyway. So I decided, well, let's try to project the video output onto the surface, then put a cylindrical mirror in the center and see what happens. And lo and behold, you do get the same cute little depiction of the original scene. Walking around it, and there's really a big difference walking around it yourself and seeing things on video. On video, it becomes again a flat image. If you do it yourself, then the perception trick actually starts to work. This is some of my initial footage, just walking around with this camera. I'm not saying that panoramic movies are a new medium, but panoramic movies shot with equipment like this is a very new medium, so we're really at the forefront of what can be done with this new medium. The interesting thing is, this is being projected on a round table that people can stand around. They stand around it, they see something in the mirror, and people automatically go like this. And if they see something moving on the table that's moving out of view, they can just walk around it. And it's a really effective way of showing people panoramas without showing them panoramas. They can also just stand around it and be quite happy discussing something completely different, and then see something in the corner of their eyes and then start interacting with the panorama. here's a bit of magic, was the table that we used, which shows nothing until you put a projection cloth on it. This is the very, very, very first footage we shot. So it's a colleague of mine and me really fooling around with it. Basically like he did, just go. And when you turn off the signal, it all of a sudden becomes a somewhat normal table again. Really magical experience. So, panamorphosis tables. All of a sudden, this very egocentric digital panorama becomes a shared experience. Like I said, people can stand around this. But you're going to take a shot, so I can do it. It's non-intrusive. It's not actually the prototype table that we build is quite big, but even so, it's not a computer. It's not something people are used to having on their work and basically hate because it crashes all the time. There's no computer in sight. It's also very simple. Basically, I take the footage from the camera and project it onto the flat surface. Then I take a mirror, and this is actually a kitchen utensil for making stacks of food if you want to be very chefy about your food. No technology involved there. It's basically a very old trick used with some new techniques. So this is really smoke and mirrors. Of course, fortunately, even without the smoke, it's not exploded yet. So another also mirror installation. Dubbed this Recollections of a Tent. It's sort of the next step after a similar but very different installation I did at the Panorama Messdorf, where I took a normal video projector, projected onto half a sphere, a spherical mirror, and that's basically the opposite of this setup, where everything around gets sort of sucked into the camera. Here we sort of did the opposite, put a beamer here, project onto the mirror, and we'd illuminate a room with panoramic images. The next step of this was Recollections of a Tent, where I didn't project onto the walls of a room, but I projected on the surface of a tent from the inside. The effect I wanted to achieve was basically showing the recollections of a tent. If you have a tent at a camping site and you have a light inside, you often intentionally or not intentionally see what happens inside. Here I wanted to show what could have happened outside the tent, but on the outside of the tent. The image that I'd project onto the sphere, half sphere, had to be deformed very specifically. So this is one of those of the panoramas that I showed. Here's another and another. You see, this is a very strangely deformed image. It sort of looks straight, well, still curved, but understandable here. It gets a lot more squeezed here, and here it gets indecipherable, basically. But if you project that onto the spherical mirror from the right distance, and you have the tent on it, which is a very precise position relative to the sphere and the projector, and it's set up in the correct way, I was predicting that you'd get something like this. So in a darkened park where the art festival took place, I'd have a tent, and the tent would show panoramic images. Again, panoramic images that you could walk around. Somewhat to my surprise, they actually worked that way. Here's actually at the second showing of the installation. You see the projector, spherical mirror, and a panoramic image being shown on the outside of the tent. This installation, by definition almost, can only be shown in rather darkness, so the video quality is all that good. But again, like the panamorphosis table, all of a sudden it becomes something that you can walk around. It also becomes something that attracts a lot of people. Tents aren't supposed to emit light, let alone tents aren't supposed to show images. So I showed it in the park arts festival. I've shown it at a kite festival. At the kite festival, I showed panoramas taken at other kite festivals. And it's really interesting to see people basically looking at the kites, coming there for the kites at the beach, kites with lights in them, so you see them at night. Very impressive, actually. And then noticing some strange tent on the boulevard. Really looking around and trying to see if they they understand how it works. I've said this a couple of times. Taking away the computer works if you want to make virtual reality, as these interactive panoramas are sometimes called, if you want to make them accessible. So, and I'll take it even a step further, you need to take away the technology so you can focus on the experience. Some time ago, virtual reality finally became a bit affordable. Here's a rather classical yet modern set of VR goggles. So in here there are two tiny computer screens, and there's also a motion sensor in here. The idea is you put this on your head, adjust the strap because it's a bit loose now, adjust the hinges that are in here so you can focus, and then by looking around you can actually experience a panorama. Now I'll show this briefly, which is a bit silly attempting to show this because because I only have one of these with me.
Let's see.
Go.
Not going entirely to plan,
which is good because that means I didn't make the warning in vain. The disclaimer that live demos sometimes go wrong. So where is that one? Okay, so I was asked by the Panorama Mister if we couldn't use this to show the current situation at the Messlach Dune, which is a bit sad. The image you see on the screen now would be on the two screens that are in here. So the effect would be that if you look up, you'll actually see sky. If you look down, you'll see the floor. Then again, I was talking about taking away the computer, taking away the technology. This, with adjusting the straps, adjusting the hinges, just wouldn't work. So what we did for the Panorama Messlach was we took away this whole part. So I took away the straps, took away the hinges, and fixed binoculars in front of them, of the actual glass, actual goggle electronics. Interestingly, that made it instantly accessible to people aged 6 through 80. So here you see the gray bit is this, and then fixed before that would be the binoculars. People can just pick up binoculars and look through them. There's currently an exhibition in Schwyz, near Luzern in Switzerland, which has a quite impressive projected panorama setup. And they're using this same system to annotate the mountain panoramas that are shown. If you want to go there, it's open until February, early February. So it's really very good. And I'm talking about the impressive panoramas that are shown there. I think I'm down to my last few minutes. So I have to start taking away some of my stuff, but there's one more thing I really want to show. This, and this shows immediately how sort of cutting edge this is and how young it is. This is a motion sensor. The computer that I've been using to present of is a rather special computer. It's a so-called tablet PC, and it allows me to detach the screen from the keyboard. Combining those two, I get something that's very interesting, because this now allows me to show a panorama on this screen, and again the experience will be much better for me than it will be for you on this screen, but I'll try to walk out and show it the best I can. So this is again an ego experience, but a very nice one. So this basically is the very same motion sensor that is in the goggles that I showed, but because it's now attached to the screen, I can now look around look down, and you see that I'm actually standing in the water. Look up, and this now becomes sort of a virtual window. A window that I keep in front of me, and that allows me to, in this case, look back at a very nice holiday. Now, like I said, this is a rather special computer and a rather sort of very technical and cutting edge piece of hardware in here. However, these types of motion sensors are actually gaining popularity very, very, very quickly. And gadgets, gadgets like the iPhone, for example, come with this type of sensor built in. The Nintendo Wii gaming console has these types of motion sensors and portable gaming solutions will very soon have the same thing. So this type of looking around in panoramas will in the near future allow us to do things with panoramas that we haven't been able to do, and allow us to think of new allow us to do new things with panoramas that they haven't been used before. This is my parents' house. It's for sale if you like it. Still hasn't been sold. What I want to show this demo for is that panoramas will probably, especially with the motion sensors in devices like the Apple iPhone, be used to show people things about places they will visit or places that they are currently at. Say, for example, I'm here, and I wanted to find the railway station. Of course, there's a very good solution for that, and that's called a map. However, maps can be held upside down. With technology like this, not anymore. So on that screen, you see the map rotating, whereas on my screen, you actually see the map being oriented in the proper direction all the time. At least that's the idea. Yeah, it's here. Yeah. So we'll never have to try to hold the map in the proper direction again. Somewhat walking ahead of what Martin will tell us, in the museum world, you could use the same type of system. Walk up to a painting, and with your virtual window, probably a bit smaller than this, look up the information. Not going through a database on a pen-based thing, but just walking around and, hey, what's this? Maybe even look into detail by going like this. This sort of thing will make working with what's actually a computer very much more intuitive and very much more nice, and something people will want to do instead of something people will have to do. So those were the demos. I hope I'm not too far off beyond my time.
Fine, thank you.